ladies and gentlemen, I was just kind of wondering the other day what it would be like if George Bilby did a Mickey Rooney and Judy Garland movie. I think it would go something like this. Why don't we do what? A show? Went to Loyola Law, but I can tell you one certain song that I bet they'd write, something about, what, parking their car?
Thank you.
lady who does tax around school. She says she does videos too. Someone in the band has a special thing for her, and he wants to tell you about that special thing right now.
Graduating senior, hopefully, and part MC of this evening. Welcome again to the Loyola Law Review 1990. We have incredible things up for you tonight, indescribable things, but we're going to describe them anyway, because that's part of the job, that's part of the gig. What are you asking? Where did I get this jacket? There it is. You know, tonight I think we should always start off with some lame comedy, and of course I would be the ones who give you the lame comedy of the night. Tonight's top 10 list is given to you tonight by Mark Bellany. is the top 10 reasons why Loyola keeps hiking its tuition. Number 10. Someone has to pay for Swain's campaign. Top 10 reasons why Loyola is hiking its tuition. Number 9. Dean Klubin needs a vasectomy. Shh. Don't tell him. Number 8. To help Keith Vedder's Magna PI. Look, he needs a red Ferrari, right? Right? That's what I thought. Number 7. To remove Ann Dummett's tattoos. It takes a lot of money, folks. This is serious surgery. Number 6, top 10 reasons why Loyola keeps hiking its tuition. Dave Gruning's bar tab at Phillips has gotten way out of hand. Number 5, we have to pay University of California, California Law Schools, to keep Vitello out of here. Number 4 of the top 10 reasons when, right, to fund Professor Lippo's new movie, Triple X movie, Tax This. I'm not making a movie. I didn't get cast in that one. I don't know why. I don't know. Something about too big an ego. Number 3 of the top 10. Not enough people are calling Father Moore's 1-900 number on Jesuit mixology tips. Somebody's got to compensate for this, folks. They're trying. That's the point behind that one. Number 2 is Hug suggested it. What a dick. I didn't mean to say that. Somebody scratch that. Okay, strike that, Your Honor. I didn't mean to say that. I meant as in Dick Tracy, the film coming out in June. Number 1, ladies and gentlemen, because Ralt wants to buy the petting farm at Audubon Zoo. I don't figure, does it? I don't know. You gotta stick Ralt in there somehow. Everybody else does it, why not me, right? The first act tonight, now that I'm through, for now, kids, is a freshman named Mark, who, well, does everybody know Leo Palazzo?
Yeah!
Leo, where you at? Leo, could you stand up over here? Where is he? Leo? Where is he? Point him out and laugh at him? You're over there? All right. Well, if everybody knows Leo Palazzo, this little sketch is about, I think, Leo's first time. Mark, take it over, babe.
Leo, where are you?
Back here.
Remember what your father calls you? Antosha, right?
Mike.
This story goes back.
Mike.
This story goes back a good many years ago to his youth. He was 19 years old at the time, and in the ways of love, he was not only unschooled, but he hadn't even been in the classroom. He was so innocent and shy that he actually thought since the beginning of time, no woman had ever been completely unclothed. And as for connubial bliss, we dared not to think of it. When it came to impregnation, he chose to believe it was caused by a husband giving his wife a most ardent handshake before retiring. But Leo, as we all know, your father was a wonderful man, quite liberal in his thinking. And on the occasion of Leo's 19th birthday, he decided to introduce him to the mysteries of love. But Leo's father was a frugal man, so he decided to escort Leo himself to see in the manner of bargaining that Leo would not be taken advantage of.
Antosha, Leo, where are you? Don't don't just stand there in the dark shaking like a little puppy dog. Come here, come here.
I'm not well, Father. I'm sick.
Sick? No, fear. Pubescent fear. I was the same way when I was your age.
I never knew you were my age. I always thought of you as older.
How old do you think I was when I was with my first woman?
You were with a woman, Father?
Certainly I was with a woman. All men who become fathers have been with a woman at some point in their life. My God, don't you ever discuss these matters with your young friends?
Oh, yes, all the time. But we get too excited to listen.
It's a man's obligation to enter the marriage experience in the ways of love. Otherwise, valuable years are wasted in endless groping.
I don't mind wasting a few years groping, Father.
It's all in the process of becoming a man, Antosha. First you learn to walk, well, then you learn to talk, and now it's time to learn this.
Are you sure, Father? I'm not walking and talking that well.
Antosha! Leo, we cannot delay any longer. Are you going to go in there and have your first experience with a woman? Or do I have to punish you?
Father, we're not going to find any woman of high moral character in there.
We're not looking for high moral women. There are damn too many high moral women in this world as it is. That's why so many high-mortal men have to come down to places like this! Now let's get on with this business.
Father, can I hold your hand?
Certainly not. You cannot expect a woman to become a man holding your father's hand. And Tosha, we don't have all day. Your mother is expecting us home by 9 o'clock. That means you have exactly 1 hour and 10 minutes for you to mature.
Jimmy, you told Mother where we were going?
Certainly not. Do you think that insensitive? I just told her we were going out for a walk to get some night air.
Well, won't she become suspicious when I come home all grown up?
It doesn't show, Anton. You don't get spots like the measles. You may have a small smile on your face, but it doesn't show.
Well, Father, aren't there other ways to become a man? I mean, couldn't I just pass out stupid cups at a crawfish boil?
Antosha. Leo, damn it, tell me the truth. If you'd rather not go through with this, I take you home.
Take me home!
Okay, I take you home. You can sit in your tub and play with your sandals until you're ready.
Father, will you be angry with me?
No.
Will you be disappointed in me?
No.
Will you be proud of me?
No.
All right, I'll do it.
Good boy, Antosha, good boy.
If I like it, can I do it again?
No. My God, it's difficult being a liberal father. Evening, gentlemen.
Oh, God!
Steady, boy, steady!
Is she one of the teachers?
She looks like a principal to me. We're in luck. She's a charming-looking girl. I'll go over and attend to your tuition.
Can I take a correspondence course?
No, stand there. I'll be right back.
A lovely April evening we're having, wouldn't you say, madame?
Is it April already? I don't get out very much.
Oh, well, I can understand that. I would like to discuss a subject of some delicacy with you.
30 rubles, so much for delicacy.
30 rubles, you say?
Well, speaking for myself, I would say 30 rubles was quite reasonable.
Oh, but it's not for me. It's for my young, inexperienced
experience son. The one over there with the knees buckling. It's still 30 rubles, sir. We don't have children's prices down here. Oh, yes. But 30 rubles does seem a bit high for a boy of 19. Would you consider, say, 15 rubles? For 15 rubles, I read Peter Rabbit. Listen, sir, a Norwegian ship is due here by 9 o'clock, and I gotta go put on my blonde wig. Oh, wait, that is one extenuating circumstance. You see, it's the boy's 19th birthday, and I thought that would get him a nice gift. What do you say? How about an umbrella? See here, in my day, 30 years ago, I shared the pleasures of the most delightful girl on this street. Ilka the Milkmaid, she was called. And she cost me a mere 10 rubles. Well, she's still here. If you want her, she's down to 6 rubles now. Certainly not! By God, he's a delightful boy, fragile and sweet. Tells the most amusing stories. I'm sure you'll find him most entertaining. Haven't we got this the wrong way around? 20 rubles, not a kopeck more. There's just so much I'm willing to spend on my boy's education. Please, it's for my boy. Settled. You're a good, loving father, and I respect you for it. If I had a father like you, I wouldn't have ended up here bargaining with fathers like you. Yes, settle then for 20 rubles. Oh, but there's just one more thing. At the conclusion of the evening's, how you say, festivities, I would appreciate it greatly if you would just say, Happy birthday from Papa! Happy birthday from Papa. Yeah. Would you like any candles, sir? No, that would not be necessary. But just be gentle and kind to him. Gentleness.
That's all I ask. A tear, what a thing to cry over.
I'll be waiting. 2 flights up, 2nd door on the left. Oh, I'll be gentle, sir. Thank you.
The girls nowadays seem to be so much more understanding.
May I say it's men like you who make me proud to serve in my profession? Oh, what a lovely nurse you would have made. And Dosha, Leo, let's go! School's in, off you go. 2 flights up, 2nd door on the left. I'll be waiting for you when you get done.
Do I say anything to her?
Like what?
Like, hello?
Hello would be nice. Goodbye would be nice too. Now off you go, Aunt Tasha.
Are there any instructions you want to give me?
That's what I'm paying her good money for. The questions you ask. Now go on before I have to pay her overtime.
Well, I'm going.
What is it now, Leo?
I was just thinking. When I come down those stairs and onto the street, well, I won't be your little Aunt Tasha anymore. I'll be Leo the Man! Oh, well, goodbye, Father, and thank you.
Wait, Aunt Tasha, wait. Wouldn't you rather have a nice umbrella?
There's plenty of time next year for you to become a man. There's plenty of time. If you wish, Papa. Yes, Papa.
You guys voted him for SBA president. Get it. That was very nice. It was good. You know, this next act is the sequel to one that was done last year, and one that has been talked about for an entire year. I will now read the introduction. Despite popular demand, welcome the return of the Legal Assets comedy troupe, Tara, Paul, and Jason. Jason put the O in rock and roll Olivier to you people for Psycho Babble 2.
This the guidance office for paranormal academic affairs. My name is Bonna von Climax.
Cabot. Marley Cabot.
Oh, Mr. Cabot. You have a brother named Raymond who's having trouble adjusting to life in law school, is that correct?
Yeah, he's been acting real strange lately. It's like he's in his own little world. I'll show you. Raymond!
Yeah.
Ray! Ray, come in here and talk to the therapist.
My brother Barley.
Ray, just sit down and talk to the therapist.
Vern, this definitely isn't my study, Carol Vern. Definitely not my study, Carol.
I mean, he's been like this ever since he had to miss the spring dance. He had his moot court argument for 7 a.m. Sunday morning. But at least he wasn't the first to go on. I tell you, it's like he's in his own little world where no professors can do him any harm. It's like he's, what do they call it? Autistic.
No, he's not autistic. He's...
Dun, dun, dun!
More autistic!
Oh, Barley, definitely hear people laughing, Barley. Definitely hear people laughing.
What the hell is autistic? Is it permanent? Is it contagious? But most importantly, can it get him out of his Saturday morning skills course?
Well, its effects can linger. And there are many factors to consider.
Yeah.
Raymond?
Yeah.
Raymond?
Yeah.
Raymond!
Uh-oh.
Are you paying attention?
Walmart.
Walmart?
Walmart in Elmwood. Supposed to eat lunch at Walmart on Thursday.
I promised I'd take him to eat at the snack bar at Walmart.
Yeah.
He cannot eat the food downstairs at the Pine Street Cafe. But then, who can?
Thursday at Pine Street is greenfish sticks and jello. Greenfish sticks and jello Thursday at 12:30. Oh, Barley, it's 12:31, Barley. We're gonna starve, Barley. There's no lunch, Barley.
I gotta get him something to eat, or else he's gonna freak out right here in your office, Doc.
Oh, okay, Raymond.
Yeah.
Raymond, listen to me.
Yeah.
We'll go to Walmart right after I ask you a few simple questions, all right?
Yeah.
I'd like to find out if he can still understand real-world concepts. Raymond?
Yeah.
How much does a candy bar cost?
About $100.
And how much does it cost to have Ann Dummett give you your exam number?
About $100.
And how much does it cost to have a Jesuit priest absolve you of your sins?
Definitely $100.
Two out of three, not bad.
That's true, Doctor. But what can you do to help him now?
Well, I'd like to engage him in some post-hypnotic suggestion. By hypnotizing him, we can discover what triggered the autism, and then maybe we can dispel any fears or confusion he might have.
Okay.
Raymond? Raymond? I'd like you to keep your eyes on the...
Barley. Barley.
Are you watching?
Yeah.
Think back on the first weeks of law school.
Yeah.
What was it that scared you?
Pet hug. Pet hug. They're very scary, pet hug.
Pet hug scared you?
Yeah, he said he wanted to be my friend. Oh. And then he said the train was leaving the station.
Okay, what, can you see him? Can you hear what he is saying?
All right, before we get started, I got some housekeeping to take care of. I want you all to know you're gonna be lawyers. You're gonna go downtown and you're gonna make big bucks. And I wanna be your friend, so come see me. But before we get started, I have to let some of you know the train's about to leave the station, and some of you just aren't on it.
Offering candy, call the police. Okay. Now, I'm wondering, Raymond, is there any professor that made you confused as to what it takes to become a lawyer?
Cows and pigs. Joe Lawson.
Joe Lawson?
Yeah. Studied the cases, read the cases, prepared. He's talking about pigs and cows and agreements.
Can you see him?
Agreements.
Yes. Can you see him?
Yeah.
Can you hear what he's saying?
Okay. So you get your judgment and you got your rat. And you pay your $1.50 and you go see the sheriff. It could be more now, I don't know. God, you suggest I use that figure. Use whatever figure you want. Okay, so you got your rat and a light bulb goes on up over your head. That's when you realize that your agreement's really just one of those hairy hand agreements. Yeah, that's it. It's a case of big chickens and little chickens. That's what the agreement's all about, you see? You see? Well, okay.
Raymond. Yep. Raymond. I want you to listen to me.
Yeah.
Joe Lawson is psychotic.
Yeah.
He's a four-dimensional thinker in a three-dimensional world. So just write down every bizarre story he tells you on the final, and you'll do just fine.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, I'm wondering, Raymond, think about your classes and discover if there are any professors that caused you any emotional reactions, any pain, any laughter.
Ha, ha, ha. George Bilby.
Bilby?
Yeah.
You like George Bilby? Can you hear what he's saying?
Yeah, Bilby told a joke.
Oh, tell us Bilby's joke.
All right, before we begin. Today, when Bilby was driving to school in, how about this, in the Bilby Mobile? So Bilby's driving to school in the Bilby Mobile, and where Pony hears a thump in the road. And they grab him from the car. Bilby finds that well, how about this? That Bilby had made a cat a part of the pavement. Being the socially conscious person Bilby is, he knocks upon a door close by and asks the owner if they indeed have a cat. So Bilby just made one part of the pavement. And the owner said, Well, sir, I do indeed have a cat. What does cat look like? And Bilby says, well, at present, the cat looks like this. Well, how about this? The owner says, well, sir, what did the cat look like before you hit it? And Bilby says that, well, if I remember correctly, it looked like this. Jocularity aside, I hear what? The winds of change blowing books closed in the back of class. Being that there's one loose end case left, pedagogy what urges us forward. So, well, how about this? We with Bilby should take the last case. What y'all think? I think that's the best thing.
Raymond.
Yeah.
George Bilby, everybody does. Even when he's serious. In fact, that's when he's the funniest.
Yeah.
So don't be ashamed to laugh at Bilby in class. It'll probably be the only response he'll get.
Yeah.
Okay, now, Raymond, I'm going to count to three and clap my hands, and when I do, you're going to wake up and you're going to go back to class and apply everything that we've learned here. And through your life, you'll be able to work through these experiences and become normal again.
Yeah.
All right. One, two, three. Raymond?
Yeah.
Are you okay?
Yeah.
Do the professors frighten you anymore?
Tell her, Ray.
Hugs sucks.
That's fine.
Oh, Barley. There's no blue books on the table, Barley. If I'm gonna take an exam, I definitely have to have blue books on the table, because once exams start, it's too late to get blue books, Barley. Definitely too late.
Ray, we're not gonna take an exam.
Yeah, definitely too late.
Doc, I hope this works. I cannot take much more of this.
I'm confident it will. Raymond, it was very nice meeting you.
Yeah.
Now, are you gonna go back to class and stay here at Loyola?
Yeah, stay here. Go back to class. Yeah. I have to make outlines. Very close exams. I have to make my outline. Definitely have to make my outline. Yeah.
Thanks again, Doc.
I'm sure I'll be fine.
Oh, Barley. Barley, these are canned outlines. I definitely can't use canned outlines. I have to have my own outlines, Barley.
Psychobabble 2, unbelievable. Ladies and gentlemen, right now, the next, I don't know if you call it an act. I'm not sure. I would like to think it's an act, but nobody really knows except that. But here's the man himself. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm pleased to announce the next governor of the United, of, what is this? Of Louisiana, ladies and gentlemen, Professor Fred Swain.
Which one of these things do I use?
Pick a mic.
Anyway,
use them all.
Is this all right?
Yeah.
Woo. God, I can't see anything up here. That's true. You know, they told me that this was an Adventures in Attitude seminar tonight. Doesn't quite seem like it here. But I think they invited me here just to give some tinge of respectability to this scandalous fiasco that we're witnessing tonight. Now, I came here really to report on the campaign to you folks, and I know everybody's very interested in that. And what I want to say about the campaign is, although we're not doing too much on our side, the other candidates are falling out like flies. So if we keep this up, I'm going to be unopposed and just going to walk right into it. Those of you who have been reading the paper have seen that the governor, Roma, has gone stark raving mad. He has really gone completely off of his nut. I know the paper said he had family trouble. They said he had the financial trouble, and obviously after his speech the other day, he has mental trouble. No question about it. Let me just read you a slight smattering of his speech here. He wants us to gather around a campfire and share Louisiana. I think it's time to gather around, hold hands, laugh, share dreams, find common ground, discover our relationship, reform our vision, feel the power of the tribal family, and start afresh. The only thing in there that rings true to me is the tribal family, because if I've ever seen a tribal family, this is it here tonight. Tribal family gathering here. But this is what he's going to use to reform Louisiana, so I figured if I just shut up and don't say anything, these other people are going to just kill themselves and I'll be basically in. I just want to give you a few points on my campaign here tonight if I could. One thing I'll do when I am governor, we're going to not charge tuition for law school. Everybody can go to law school. All we're going to do is take 70%, 75% of your earnings for the rest of your career in practice. But everybody can go to law school and be a lawyer. You understand? They can do that. As governor, I will appoint students to evaluate teachers, and I mean real evaluations. If the marks are low, out they go. No question about it. No parasites in law school. Sorry, Cleb, I don't know if you're out there or not. You know, speaking of my young Polack friend, Klepper, speaking of him, do you remember that we had decided that he was a Klingon? Do you remember that we knew he wasn't human, but we weren't too sure what he was and we thought he was a Klingon? Well, I think maybe we were wrong, because I saw a movie the other night, and it convinced me that maybe he's a teenage mutant ninja turtle. Looks just like him. It's either him or some relation of his, I'll tell you that. I don't know. But the man obviously was in the movie. No question about it. I also think that we have to bring openness to the classroom. I think we have to have an open give and take. And so I think that all law teaching should be done in the nude. I mean total nakification. I love this nakification business. I've been waiting for nakification tonight. It looks like I'm going to wait forever at this damn thing. But we need total nakification. We need the openness. We need to foster the give and take that we can have in the classroom. This is a great idea, but this is not my idea. Several weeks ago, for an entire week, the German Gruning taught his classes nude, and nobody noticed. Of course, it's such a little thing, I don't know why I bring it up. Is that somebody attacking me there, running across there? I was going to suggest that they do the deaning nude, but then I thought of Norman and Clever, and I said, no. That's disgusting, isn't it? Now listen, if I could give you just a little personal note, because, you know, I'm politicking tonight. You know the campaign must be lagging if I come here to make a speech, right? But I had a little personal note. The girl asked me to tell you that she's very sorry she can't be with you tonight. She's at one of those kill all the men, radical, rabid feminine movements up in Washington, D.C. You see? She is, but I'm here to make an official announcement concerning her. She is going to be the first appointment I make when I'm elected governor. And I'm going to appoint her secretary of sex. Because you know how she loves all that dirty stuff. She just eats it up. She just loves it, you know? She goes wild over it. See, I'm telling you that over in the lobby of the law school a couple of weeks ago, she was almost having an orgasm over National Orgasm Week. And it was National Orgasm Week. People walking in the lobby and she said, hey, did you know it's National Orgasm Week? I said, female type creature, shut up. People are going to get the wrong idea. You know, you can't keep doing this. I'll tell you this. The other day in the faculty lounge, she started talking about, well, I can't tell you. That's too embarrassing to me. Let me just say this. Professor Rhett Clark was in the lounge and she heard it. So anyone wants to know what Loyola was with the girl, excuse me, what the girl was talking about, she'd go ask Professor Rhett Clark, okay, and she'll be glad to tell you all about it. Disgusting, absolutely disgusting. Now, I do have one announcement to make, and that is that in Dean Clubber, in announcing the new dean choice, got it wrong. After they told him about Lewis Westerfield, the Jesuitites over there called me over and asked me to come talk to them about it. And they've chosen another dean. They've changed their minds. And the new dean is, I'm proud to announce, Garrison Aloysius Silva. Now, while I was over there, I learned something. I really learned something, you know? And what I learned, frankly, was that you don't have to be a lawyer to be dean. Thus, I thought Gary was a great choice because there's not much chance that he's going to become a lawyer, and he'll make a great dean. You know, I just thought it was a good choice. Let me just say that as governor, I will fully support the diversification campaign. But we have too much talk, too many words about it. Let's get down to brass tacks. Let's see some action. Those faculty members who think we need more diversity on the faculty, let them quit their job, resign, so somebody that will bring diversity can come on the faculty. Too many words, not enough action, okay? You know how that's gonna float. You know, it's the same old story. Everybody wants to see Jesus, but nobody wants to die. And that's what all this is about, right there. And all this high talk. Just one final point, if I could make it. My position on environmental pollution is that the best way to handle the environmental problem is to kill one environmentalist a week until they're all gone. But other than that, I think the best thing I could do for the environment is outlaw this event tonight, the scandalous spectacle that we have tonight here. Anything. In closing, I want to congratulate the boys who are apparently taking over the law school again. The boys who have taken over Law Review, I mean the other Law Review, the respectable Law Review over there. And the boys who are winning now at moot court. Actually, I think what it is that the boys have not won at moot court for 122 years and have not been on a Law Review for 72 years. And I think what the girls are doing, in order so there won't be too much scandal about it, they're every 30 or 40 years going to let them win something, you know? And of course, I'm outraged because a woman should never take orders from a man being born again and should never be under a man. So I'm outraged about the whole thing. Let me just say that I appreciate your support and that I'm going to look forward to campaigning with you. When you come campaign, please bring your guns along just in case. Thank you very much.
First time that I know of, at least in the last 3 years, that a professor has done anything at this completely student event. And I think, I'm not going to be here next year, but if he's governor, I'm definitely moving. That's the thing, I mean, I don't know. You piss too many people off, professor. I don't know. Have some beer, you know, who knows. The next thing we have up is Margaret Lagatuda's Family Feud, starring the inimitable Gary Silva.
Dean Silva.
Dean Silva. That's who you're
going. You're fifth.
You're
fifth.
No, it's more.
What it is?
Okay.
Yeah. Brett.
Daphne, you're from Tom.
Or Swift.
Well, I am. Is that the liar?
Tonight's Family Feud is between the Law Review, the top 10% of the class, and the Law Review, the top bottom 90% of the class.
Oh, boys!
And before we get started, we want to introduce everyone. But before we do that, we want to know how many people have a vote for Leo Cup? By the way, you can get them, they're 75 cents on the way out. Over to our side of Law Review, we start off with Liz Ditch. You know Liz.
I can't believe it.
You can't believe it? You should have had her in moot court. Next person is Tom Leaves Them Rare. Everyone knows Daphne McSlut. If you don't know Mark, I want those jeans when they get old, Bellamy.
Hey man, these are my dad's.
Yeah, the old dad trick. Oh, okay. Man. And everyone knows Brett. Would you believe Brett looks like Mel Gibson?
No.
And also our all-time favorite is Margaret Latta, don't mess with my tutu. To this side, we got Patty Pumpenheimer.
That big one here.
Jackie, she looks like she lost the hunt. Margaret looking for Mr. Goodbar. Sean, Chrissy, please give him more. And Joe Mazzolini.
Okay.
Yo-ho. We're pulling the 100 average law students in the top 10 answers are on the board. The first question is, what do you do in your spare time?
I know.
Make out.
Outlines.
Bang. How many people here make outlines? Your answer?
Copy their outlines.
Yeah! 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 Let's have a little audience participation.
Good answer.
Law review, number one. Do you pass?
Wait, hold on.
Not in here.
We passed, we're prepared. Oh, they're right, we're prepared. Sure sounds like Bilby's class.
I lost that brief. I'm sorry.
Barbie, what you answer?
Well, I can't decide. Two things. See, I love to look at something like Cunningham's, you know, his horn book on property and go through the footnotes.
What's Cunningham's
book?
Happy Days is canceled.
And read a treatise.
I need my black dictionary to find out what that is. Joe, where's Joe?
No, we're on this side.
Oh, I'm sorry. Which way?
No, they're back on this side.
They're back over there.
Joe McLean, what do you think we should do?
Kiss up to the faculty.
All you girls, remember that, Professor Hogg? He's pretty good at that. You don't have to be in a Final Four to get an A. Just for
that. That's too strong.
That's for you.
All right, correct. Who do I go to? Sean?
You got Sean.
But don't talk into...
Oh, Sean, Chrissy's still going to give you more. What did you say?
Get drunk at Phillips every Thursday night.
Oh, yeah!
What is Phillips, Sean?
Cherokee and Mabel.
Oh, okay, we'll make that.
Yeah,
good.
Right.
What about...
Gary didn't study again, you can tell.
Last chance here, and we're going over to Mark. Where is Mark?
One more chance.
Come on,
Joe.
Jackie's always knows everything.
Well, what I like to do is I like to take the original case from the casebook, go find the long version, and then standardize it and read all those cited cases.
Question, but that is the wrong answer. Although Jack and I do that, we're
going to
go to this side.
Masturbate,
isn't
the answer masturbate?
Lizzie Daphne over here, our two friends. They tied for first place in the annual law review color on competition. They both colored on, as you can see.
Ringers.
Okay, the law review again. What do you do in your spare time? We're going to death.
I'm sorry, Mr. Hypo. What was the question?
What do you do in your spare time besides dress in a closet?
Go counsel.
Well, we like to whack the white one. Play golf.
No problem. You talk too much.
Good answer.
Whack the white one. I don't think so. Well, let's go to Liz, and let's see what she has to say to wrap things up.
What we like to do is drink beer at the Law Review and jam to Bad Faith.
Yeah!
Let's have it here for our panel. Thanks.
going to call the band back up here at this juncture in our law school careers. Where is Bad Fate? Get up here. Right now. Mike, the Master Monastere. Keys. Jimmy, Big Jimmy Holmes, lead guitar. Adrian, the Pillsbury Pounder on drums. We got Roy, Rocket Roy Levine on the harp and the backups. Last and Brian Gilbert again on lead on rhythm guitar. And Jason put the O in rock and roll. Olivier. First song. We gotta dedicate this. This first song is gonna be dedicated to our new ex-dean. I don't think he's gonna like it. Do it. All identify with this one, whether it's about a girl or a guy. Let's do it.
She's a girl.
Except maybe the top, what, 10% or something?
Yeah.
Everybody else will get it. Oh, this is called improv, Mark. Anyway, here's a song from way back when. We've done many times, but never better. And it's going to be done right now by Mr. Mark Belloni. So you can kill these four cats and eat them red beans and rice! Hooray! that. Ladies and gentlemen, can I have your attention? The first act of the second set is soon to occur. That's right. It's her. You want to sit down and watch her, don't you? A red Dodge Omni
right.
is soon to get towed because it is parked in the driveway.
Halfway in the driveway.
Halfway parked in the driveway. I think somebody needs to re-park their car.
It's already got a ticket.
It's already got a ticket, and I think it's going to be towed. What is it?
It's on Pine Street.
A red Dodge Omni on Pine Street.
Red Dodge Omni, I think it's 542, whatever, I can't remember things.
Nobody knows there.
Nobody knows their license plate number, but a red Dodge Omni is about to get towed! Ah! The point being made, our first act of the second set for Law Review 90 is the lovely and talented Tara Malina.
I can't see with that light in my eyes. Thank you. Now, this song is dedicated to all the law babes in the room. I know that you've all experienced this. Mr. Partner or Mr. Professor just adores you. And he would love for you to look at him lovingly and say, "Oh, Mr. Partner, oh, Mr. Swain, oh, you're such a man. You're such a man. And please, please, violate me in sweet violet time in the vilest way that you know. Ravish me rapidly, lewdly, lasciviously, upon me no mercy bestow. Oh, Mr. Partner, of all the great mysteries we are oblivious, so give us a love that is lewd and lascivious. Violate me in sweet violet time in the vilest way that you know." Thank you very much. And our next act. And our next act is Calm Gaseous Wear. And now. No, it's not. Oh, well. What is it? Ooh, ooh. It's rapping Mark Bellany, right? It's the Poverty Law Rap! All right, let's hear a big warm welcome for Mark Bellany!
Welcome home, boys and home girls. This is my rapid bot, Jason. Put the O in rap, Olivier.
And fool too.
Faster, baby. It was just the other day I was feeling okay, and all kinds of things they was going my way. See, I'm a law school guy and I'm getting out soon. I take the bar in July, not June. I'll be a lawyer, attorney, I'll go real far, and if I play my cards right, I'll be a superstar. Now I'm hanging in the park, just thinking about my future. I don't have no job yet, I'm still just a moocher. Do I do PIs, some slip and fall, or do I prosecute? Nah, I don't have the balls. See, now what do I do for my security? I have to escape my poverty.
Well then, out of the woods and before my eyes came this ragamuffin kind of scraggly guy. He said, hey rich boy, check this out. I'm a poor raggy mother, man, there ain't no doubt. He said, I'm hungry, I'm starving like the homeless type. But I got my pride, I ain't no gotcha snipe. I said, now, hey man, I know where you're at. I'm familiar with the plight of the indigent cat. Cause I took this class from a priest at my school. He said, it's unfair, it's real uncool that you have to live in a society when the whole generation is worried about me. You know it's true, boys and girls. So I gave the man a dollar and he said thanks a lot. Shook his hand and then he went away. You know he went away happy on that day. And I started to reflect on what that priest had to say. I know that I have got at least a couple bucks, but I still know that poverty sucks. Well, this poverty class, it was a pain in the ass, but you had to take it and you had to pass. Now the buzz of social security talk welfare. We played beat bingo and we slept in our chair. Oh sure, it was boring. We went to sleep up in 308. We counted thousands of sheep. And every once in a while, you know, we'd wake and we'd look around and see what notes we could take. Oh, hell with it, man, I'm making millions of bucks. And I'll still know that poverty sucks. Yeah, it does. Well, then exam time came, it was all up to fate. It's time to read the shit so I could graduate. Well, studying, man, what a bummer. But better now than in the summer. Then got the test and the bomb was dropped. And I knew that I had flopped. But the exam grades came in, I lucked out. I lucked out with a big D plus. Oh yeah. But then I started to reflect on what that priest had to say as I took poverty law exam on that day. I think I realize now what the man had stressed is that we all got to strive to be the best. Attorney, lawyer, a public slave. Even if it means we have to deal with the names. So what did this class mean to a guy like me who has no link to poverty? It's a social understanding that we have to see to realize our role in society. See, we'll all be making millions of bucks. Pray you don't learn firsthand that poverty sucks. Pray you don't learn firsthand that poverty sucks.
Thank you. Jason, go box, Olivier.
What's next?
Where'd it go? I don't know. Ladies and gentlemen, now next is another game show, and a game show that I think we can all respect and identify with at some point in our junctures in our law school careers. This is another sequel. This is a new version, the Law Review 90 version of Jeopardy.
Where's Arlen?
Keep it up. Now entering the stage is three prostitutes from Pine Street Cafe. Charlotte Harlot Lagarde. Dana Banana Schwab. And Daphne Nixlut. And here's your host, Tom Gash's Rare Quebec.
I have no idea what I'm doing.
Shut up, Joey. Get us off this thing.
We're going up here. Thank you and welcome to Jeopardy. Daphne, will you start? Wait, here. Pick a category. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. Our categories are the administration, left-wing losers, places, Bellevue teachers, and miscellaneous teachers. Daphne, pick a category.
Administration.
All right.
For 100.
And the question is, if he wants to be your buddy, you might find yourself in trouble. Schwab.
Who is Glenn?
Very good. For 100 points. Pick a category. Same one.
Administration for 200, please.
For 200 points. This, the dean can be seen chasing the thieves on his bicycle. Lagarde. Yes! For 200 points.
Administration for $300, please.
For $300, and now, for a little tongue-in-cheek, this secretary/self-proclaimed dean mysteriously falls ill whenever grades are to be posted. McNutt.
Dammit.
Yes, for 300 points.
Who is?
Please phrase the question correctly. And your next category.
Left-wing losers
for 100. He has taken leave to live on the streets in order to get more material for his utterly useless but required course. Schwab!
Who is Father Gallagher?
Yes!
Left-wing losers for 200, please.
For 200 points. In this professor's house, you are likely to find goat excrements. Big butt!
Who is wrong?
That's correct.
What is wrong?
Well, what is wrong is more correct. You pick the category.
Same category, next price.
$300. This professor's course might be entitled The Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Meet the Supreme Court. Schwab?
Who is Professor Rosen?
Very good. For 300 points. Pick a category.
Places for 100, please.
Places for 100. You'd do better handing out your resume to bums in Lee Circle than leaving it here. Lagarde.
What is the placement office?
Places for 200. Here, you can find students studying carnal knowledge on Thursday nights. Schwab!
What
for
is
200.
Phillips? What?
You
didn't
know.
All right, Joe.
Next question.
Okay, places for 300, please.
For $300. Although students have complained for 2 years, you still won't find hand towels here. McNutt.
The bathroom.
What is the bathroom? Is the correct answer.
Where is the bathroom? Where is the bathroom?
There's a pot under there.
Okay.
Pick a category.
Is that the end of that one?
Yeah.
Bellevue teachers
for 100. Wait, I'm sorry. We didn't acknowledge Shelly Shitty here. For $100, this professor's first words to the legislature might be, "Let's try to get out a little early today." Lagarde!
Swain!
Swain is correct!
Bellevue teachers for 200, please.
For $200,
She is no longer abrasive, but still remains taxing when trying to understand her teaching. Schwab.
Who is Professor Lipo?
Professor Lipo would be correct.
Bellevue teaches with 300, please, Tom.
With $300. Despite the appearance in his name, this professor knows only of sheep and cows, not the law. Schwab.
Who is Professor Lawson?
Professor Lawson would be correct. Pick a category.
Okay, miscellaneous teachers for 100, please, Tom.
Okay, if you are a female student, this professor's hairpiece may fall into your beer at the next TGIF. McNutt.
Who is Professor Bro?
Professor Bro is Bro. For $200, attempting to lure seniors to class at 8:30 leaves a sour taste in this visiting professor's mouth.
Who is Professor Lemon?
Professor Lemon would be correct.
Miscellaneous teachers for $300, please.
For $300, on this professor's nose you will find the ink from the book from which he could not teach without. Jeopardy question is, the category is student-teacher relations. This professor with sweaty armpits and holes in his sleeves needs to be informed that he is not a god and students are for teaching, not playing. Schwab.
Who is Professor Gabriel?
Very good. And you win the game.
Among those thanks to Tom, the madman rare.
Never mind.
Bring that table back.
Never mind.
Holy cow. You know, folks, everybody deserves their day of reckoning. And I think, in some respect, this being a very momentous occasion, thanks to the new dean being announced today, I think it's time for Dean Clevitt's Day of Reckoning.
Church lady. And today our special guest is none other than the acting dean of Loyola Law School. His major accomplishments include posting bike memos to students and meekly allowing tuition to be raised for the third year in a row. Please give a warm Church Chat welcome to Dean Clibo. Excuse me?
Clibo.
Cleaver.
Clever.
Well, isn't that special? Now say hello to all your students.
Hi.
Well, my. Tell me, acting dean, and I think the key word there is acting. What's it like to be out in public speaking?
It's something I avoid.
Well, where's Kathy Schwab? Couldn't cover your buns for this one, eh? Well, let me ask you some questions that have been plaguing the hearts of law students for a long time. If you make all this money from tuition, why can't you afford a car?
I have a car, church lady. I like to ride my bike because it keeps me in good physical condition.
Well, I can see that. You must still be a growing boy because your head's growing right through the top of your hair. So there you are on your little bike with your little training wheels, riding up and down the street, your buttocks glistening in the sunshine. Gyrating up and down, left and right. Your tiny nasty bits pressed firmly against the leather seat. Well, enough of that. Tell me, as dean, what exactly is it that you do?
Well, I coordinate the fiscal responsibilities of the law school with the main campus. I engage in fact-finding for the board of advisors. Well, I guess you could call me...
Well, you're a gopher, aren't you? You're just a gopher for the Jesuit bourgeoisie. And as acting gopher, do you have much input on the rising tuition costs? Well, wake up, Your Highness! You don't have to fall asleep on me. I'm just Church Lady, not Justice Powell. Dean Klondike.
Clever.
Whatever. Well, tell me, Dean Gopher, why is it that a school so interested in staying competitive with other law schools refuses to adopt a grading policy? I think we should know that.
Well, as you know, our professors have a unique system of grading. And if we were to adopt some sort of grading policy, it could compromise the uniqueness of our approach.
Well, I certainly believe that. When your professors are tossing exams down a stairwell, it's hard to ensure that 60% or more fall in the second step or above. Not enough about that. Tell me about your placement office. I understand graduating seniors have a better chance of getting a job if they run their resume in a singles magazine. Is that true?
That is absolutely not true. We've made great progress in that area. But Kathy Schwab is running things, and she never tells me anything. But I do know that our skills courses are a big help to our graduates in adjusting to life as a lawyer.
Well, I can certainly believe that. Lord knows what law students would do without all that extra time to sleep and study and read magazines. Enough of that. Let's quit beating around the bush, shall we? Are you prepared to take an oath of loyalty to your students in light of all your wrongdoings to receive absolution?
I don't think I have.
Well, that's fine. Repeat after me. I, Dean Clever.
Klondike.
That was that special. I, Dean Klondike, do solemnly swear.
I, Dean Clever, do... Oh, this is ridiculous. I've had enough of this. I do the best I can, and if you don't like it, tough. I never wanted to be a lawyer anyway. I always wanted to be a lumberjack.
Swinging from tree to tree as they float down the mighty rivers of British Columbia.
Well, well, isn't that just extra special? I guess he's not the gutless wonder we all thought he was. But still, what could it have been? What could I have said that got him so mad that the little red veins on his little exposed scalp got so big? What could it have been that got him so mad? I don't know. Let's see. Could it have been Satan? Well, that's it for church chat. I'm Church Lady. Goodbye. Hit it, Carl.
At this time, you know, while we're waiting for the stage to get set up for the band to come back, I'd like to thank a lot of people that have helped tonight. Margaret Ligatuda for getting the food and stuff. I'd like to thank Jason Olivier, not only for being the most talented guy who we've ever seen on this stage in this school.
Jason Olivier.
Jason Olivier. I'd also like to thank Shelley, who also helped put the doodle book together. Jason was behind that also, which has made it the best doodle book, and the second, the best out of two, the better doodle book of two. I'd like to thank Kenny and Jody, the people that are responsible for helping us with the lights tonight, making this a full theatrical affair. There's so many, we did a lot of things to get this thing together, and this is by far the most popular, the most attended law review, I think, in the last, as long as I've been here. Last 2 years! Yeah! Yeah! What he said! But,
sew it up your jeans!
No, it was your mother. What is this? Heckling from the crowd. This is law review, and I don't do that. But, I don't know, I think Dean Clever forgot to mention something about using Etch-a-Sketch pads as blue books. I think it's going to make it harder for the professors to throw those down the stairs to get our grades in. Etch-a-Sketch, things with you know what? Are we ready for Bad Faith again, folks? I can't rock no more! I can't do no more! I can't do no more! Where's my band? Where's my band?
Here.
Ow! Ladies and gentlemen, have some static in your face. Ow! We got Rock and Roy Levine, ladies and gentlemen. On the This next song is dedicated to Gary Silver. Gary Silver. I don't know what's happening next. But I feel a jam coming on. Is that right, Roy?
That's right, huh?
Yeah, you're right.
Hold it down, we got hot door.
Let's rock.
We need this guy.
Out there, Ryan!
talk a little bit about him.
What the hell in shoes?
But that's okay. He's behind my back. I'm kidding.
Y'all want to hear one more? I don't know. What do you think, guys? Can we get one more?
You want to hear one more? Bring it home to them, boys.
Thank you. for giving us the place to clap.
Yeah, thanks. Good night, everybody.
Thanks, everybody, for showing up.